Next theorem is prove that the boundary of set complement of G is subset of Z. Now we know that since G is the set of all invertible vector and again it is a open set. So it is a G is a open set. So it implies complement of G which is a closed set. Now suppose B of GC is a boundary of set complement of G. So our purpose is to prove this is a subset of capital Z. So we take let X belongs to boundary of complement of G. Then by definition, there exists a sequence Pn in G such that Pn approaches to P as n approaches to infinity. Now we take Pn inverse P minus identity. This identity basically equal to Pn inverse into Pn. This is because Pn is a part of G and G is the set of all invertible vector. So it means Pn is invertible, Pn is regular. So inverse of Pn exists. So this can be written in this form, that is written in equation number 1. Our claim is the sequence Pn inverse is unbounded. So it is not a bounded sequence. Suppose this Pn inverse is a bounded sequence. If this is a bounded sequence, also Pn approaches to P. So it means P minus Pn approaches to 0 as n approaches to infinity. Again, this norm of Pn inverse, which is into P minus Pn, this approaches to 0. Why? Because this sequence, one sequence is bounded and other sequence converge to 0. If one sequence is bounded, the second sequence converge to 0, then the product approaches to 0 as n approaches to infinity. Now, it implies Pn inverse P minus E. This can be written in this form. Identity is written in the form of Pn inverse into Pn. It implies Pn inverse into P minus Pn nor. So this is by less than equal to norm of Pn inverse into norm of P minus Pn. This term approaches to 0. So the entire product, this entire product approaches to 0 as n approaches to infinity. If this approaches to 0, then it means this norm of Pn inverse P minus E approaches to 0 as n approaches to infinity. And 0 is less than 1. So this norm of this sequence, this vector is less than 1. Then by again using the result, if this minus identity less than 1, then Pn inverse P is invertible. Invertible or it is a regular. If it is a regular, then P can be written in the form of Pn. Pn inverse into P. Now this is invertible. Pn is invertible. The product of two invertible vector is also a invertible. If it is invertible, then it implies P is invertible. If P is invertible, then P belongs to G. But P does not belongs to G because P belongs to complement of G, so which contradict our assumption. If it contradict, then it means the sequence Pn inverse is not bounded. If not bounded, then norm of Pn inverse approaches to infinity as n approaches to infinity. Now we consider another sequence whose norm is equal to 1. We consider Pn inverse over norm of Pn inverse. When we take the norm of En, this norm will become 1. and P into En, if we multiply this sequence with respect to P, then P into En, which is equal to P into Pn inverse over norm of Pn inverse, which can be written as E plus P Pn inverse minus E. Now, this E can be written in the form of Pn into Pn inverse, because Pn is invertible. So this value is equal to E plus P into Pn inverse minus Pn into Pn inverse over norm of Pn inverse. This is equal to E over norm of Pn inverse plus P into Pn into Pn inverse, that is common from last two terms, over norm of Pn inverse. This value can be written in the form of E over norm of Pn inverse plus P into Pn into En. So this entire term approaches to zero as n approaches to infinity, because this term approaches to infinity. So 1 by this term approaches to zero. Again, we know that En approaches to zero. So this product is approaches to zero as n approaches to infinity. So it implies P belongs to Z. So it implies, so from this, what we get P belongs to Z. Why P belongs to Z? So first, remind the value of Z. Z is the set of all, I revise the value of Z. So Z is the set of all topological divisor of zero, right? What do you mean by topological divisor? Topological divisor means if we have an element X belongs to A, which is said to be a topological divisor of zero. If there exists a sequence Xn in A with the norm of Xn equal to 1, either X into Xn approaches to zero or Xn into X approaches to zero. Now, in this article, what we get, we take some P and that P, and then there exists a sequence En, that En sequence whose norm is equal to 1, that is norm of equal to 1, and then we probe P into En, this approaches to 0 as n approaches to infinity, then it means P is a vector P is a topological divisor of zero. It means P belongs to Z. It implies boundary of complement of G, which is a subset of capital Z. So this is our result. So next result is division algebra. So what is division algebra? A division algebra is an algebra with identity such that every non-zero element is invertible or unit or regular. So this is a definition of division algebra. So first theorem is, let A be a complex division algebra, then A is isomorphic to C. Let X belongs to A, since sigma X spectrum of X is non-empty, then there exists, by definition of sigma X, there exists at least one lambda such that lambda belongs to sigma X. This means X minus lambda is singular. If X minus lambda is singular, then it implies it is a non-invertible. The inverse of this vector does not exist. Clear? If it is a non-invertible, because the given part is ki every non-zero in division algebra, every non-zero vector is invertible. But this is not invertible. It means those vector which are not invertible are zero. It implies x minus lambda equal to zero. If x minus lambda is equal to zero, then x can be written in the form of lambda e. So remember this, if x belongs to A, then x is equal to lambda e. Why? Because of property of division algebra. If this is a invertible, this is a non-invertible. If this is a singular, then this value is equal to zero and x equal to lambda e. In order to prove isomorphism, so we take psi from A to C. The vector of A is like this, x, which is lambda e, and element of C is lambda, which is a scalar, for every x belongs to A. So x is equal to lambda e. So first, 1, 1, let psi of x1, which is equal to psi of x2, it implies lambda 1e, which is equal to lambda 2e. It implies lambda 1, which is equal to lambda 2. So it implies x1 is equal to x2. So psi is 1, 1. Second, for every lambda belongs to C, there exists a lambda e belongs to A, such that it satisfies this condition. So psi is on. So this is a the mapping from this A to C is 1, 1 on to, also it is a linear transformation. So it is a 1, 1 on to. So A is isomorphic to C. So this is our result. Now next lemma is, let A be a complex Banach algebra. Then sigma of xn, which is equal to sigma x raised to power n. This is for every x belongs to A. Now, what is the definition? Definition of sigma x is lambda belongs to C, such that x minus lambda e singular, if this is a singular. Now, definition of lambda xn, which is a lambda belongs to C, such that x raised to power n minus lambda is singular. This is a singular. Now, if this is a singular, this equation is equal to zero, then it is a equation with the degree n. So it has n root. If it has n root and linear root, let lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda n be distinct n root of this equation. If these are n root of this equation, then this equation can be written in this form, xn minus lambda e, which is equal to x minus lambda 1 e, and so on, x minus lambda n e. Now this is a singular. If this is a singular, mean it is zero. If and only if one of these factor is a zero, if the xn minus lambda e singular, if and only if x minus lambda e singular for at least one I. If it is singular for at least one I, then it implies sigma of xn, which is equal to sigma x raised to power n. This is our result. Now, our next result is very important. So, next result is, let A be a complex Banach algebra with identity E. Show that R sigma X, which is a spectral radius of R, which is equal to limit n approaches infinity norm of X raised to power n and sare the raised to power 1 by n. So this is very important result. So we will prove in the next lecture. So thank you very much.